This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book 5440 or Fight by Emerson Hough. Chapter 1: The Makers of Maps. There is scarcely a single cause in which a woman is not engaged in some way fomenting the suit. Juvenal. Then you offer me no hope, doctor. The gray mane of Dr. Samuel Ward waved like a fighting crest as he made answer. Not the sort of hope you ask. A moment later he added, John, I am ashamed of you. The cynical smile of the man I called my chief still remained upon his lips. The same drawn look of suffering still remained upon his gaunt features, but in his blue eye I saw a glint which proved that the answer of his old friend had struck out some unused spark of vitality from the deep cold flint of his heart. I never knew you for a coward, Calhoun, went on Dr. Ward, nor any of your family. I give you now the benefit of my personal acquaintance with this generation of the Calhouns. I ask something more of you than faint-heartedness. The keen eyes turned upon him again with the old flame of flint which a generation had known, a generation for the most part of enemies. On my chief's face I saw appear again the fighting flush, proof of his hard-fibered nature, ever ready to rejoin with challenge when challenge came. Did not Saul fall upon his own sword? Asked John Calhoun. Have not devoted leaders from the start of the world till now sometimes rid the scene of the responsible figures in lost fights, the men on whom blame rested for failures? Cowards, rejoined Dr. Ward. Cowards, every one of them. Were there not other swords upon which they might have fallen, those of their enemies? It is not my own hand, my own sword, Sam, said Calhoun. Not that. You know as well as I that I am already marked and doomed, even as I sit at my table tonight. A walk of a wet night here in Washington, a turn along the heights out there when the winter wind is keen. Yes, Sam, I see my grave before me, close enough, but how can I rest easy in that grave? Man, we have not yet dreamed how great a country this may be. We must have Texas. We must have also Oregon. We must have free. The old doctor shrugged his shoulders and smiled at the arch pro-slavery exponent. Then, since you mention it, yes, retorted Calhoun fretfully. But I shall not go into the old argument of those who say that black is white, that south is north. It is only for my own race that I plan a wider America. But then, Calhoun raised a long, thin hand. Why, he went on slowly, I have just told you that I have failed. And yet you, my old friend, whom I ought to trust, condemn me to live on. Dr. Samuel Ward took snuff again, but all the answer he made was to waggle his gray mane and stare hard at the face of the other. Yes, said he at length, I condemn you to fight on, John, and he smiled grimly. Why, look at you, man, he broke out fiercely after a moment. The type and picture of combat. Good bone, fine bone and hard, a hard head and bony, little eye set deep, strong wiry muscles not too big, fighting muscles not dough, clean limbs, strong fingers, good arms, legs, neck, wide chest. Then you give me hope. Calhoun flashed a smile at him. No, sir. If you do your duty, there is no hope for you to live. If you do not do your duty, there is no hope for you to die, John Calhoun, for more than 2 years to come, perhaps 5 years, six. Keep up this work, as you must, my friend, and you die as surely as though I shot you through as you sit there. Now, is this any comfort to you? A gray pallor overspread my master's face. That truth is welcome to no man, morbid or sane, sound or ill, but brave men meet it as this one did. Time to do much, he murmured to himself. Time to mend many broken vessels in those 2 years. One more fight, yes, let us have it, But Calhoun the man was lost once more in Calhoun the visionary, the fanatic statesman. He summed up, as though to himself, something of the situation which then existed at Washington. Yes, the coast is clearer now that Webster is out of the cabinet, but Mr. Upshur's death last month brings in new complications. Had he remained our Secretary of State, much might have been done. It was only last October he proposed to Texas a treaty of annexation. Yes, and found Texas none so eager, frowned Dr. Ward. No, and why not? You and I know well enough. Sir Richard Pakenham, the English plenipotentiary here, could tell if he liked. England is busy with Texas. Texas owes large funds to England. England wants Texas as a colony. There is fire under this smoky talk of Texas dividing into two governments, one at least under England's gentle and unselfish care. And now look you, Calhoun continued, rising and pacing up and down, look what is the evidence. Van Zandt, chargé d'affaires in Washington for the Republic of Texas, wrote Secretary Upshur only a month before Upshur's death and told him to go carefully or he would drive Mexico to resume the war and so cost Texas the friendship of England. Excellent, Mr. Van Zandt. I at least know what the friendship of England means. So, he asks us if we will protect Texas with troops and ships, in case she does sign that agreement of annexation. Cunning Mr. Van Zandt. He knows what that answer must be today, with England ready to fight us for Texas and Oregon both, and we wholly unready for war. Cunning Mr. Van Zandt, covert friend of England. And lucky Mr. Upshur, who was killed, and so never had to make that answer. But John, another will have to make it, the one way or the other, said his friend. Yes. The long hand smote on the table. President Tyler has offered you Mr. Upshur's portfolio as Secretary of State? Yes. The long hand smote again. Dr. Ward made no comment beyond a long whistle as he recrossed his legs. His eyes were fixed on Calhoun's frowning face. There will be events, said he at length, grinning. I have not yet accepted, said Calhoun. If I do, it will be to bring Texas and Oregon into this union, one slave, the other free, but both vast and of a mighty future for us. That done, I resign at once. Will you accept? Calhoun's answer was first to pick up a paper from his desk. See, here is the dispatch Mr. Pakenham brought from Lord Aberdeen of the British Ministry to Mr. Upshur just 2 days before his death. Judge whether Aberdeen wants liberty or territory. In effect, he reasserts England's right to interfere in our affairs. We fought one war to disprove that. England has said enough on this continent. And England has meddled enough. Calhoun and Ward looked at each other, sober in their realization of the grave problems which then beset American statesmanship and American thought. The old doctor was first to break the silence. Then do you accept? Will you serve again, John? Listen to me. If I do accept, I shall take Mr. Upshur's and Mr. Nelson's place only on one condition. Yes, if I do, here is what I shall say to England regarding Texas. I shall show her what a Monroe Doctrine is, shall show her that while Texas is small and weak, Texas and this republic are not. This is what I have drafted as a possible reply. I shall tell Mr. Pakenham that his chief's avowal of intentions has made it our imperious duty in self-defense to hasten the annexation of Texas, cost what it may, mean what it may. John Calhoun does not shilly-shally. That will be my answer, repeated my chief at last. Again they looked gravely, each into the other's eye, each knowing what all this might mean. Yes, I shall have Texas, as I shall have Oregon, settled before I lay down my arms, Sam Ward. No, I am not yet ready to die. Calhoun's old fire now flamed in all his mien. The situation is extremely difficult, said his friend slowly. It must be done, but how? We are, as a nation, not ready for war. You, as a statesman, are not adequate to the politics of all this. Where is your political party, John? You have none. You have outrun all parties. It will be your ruin that you have been honest. Calhoun turned on him swiftly. You know as well as I that mere politics will not serve. It will take some extraordinary measure, you know, men, and perhaps women. Yes, said Dr. Ward, and a precious silly lot. They are, the two running after each other and forgetting each other, using and wasting each other, ruining and despoiling each other all the years from Troy to Rome. But yes, for a man, set a woman for a trap. Vice versa, I suppose. Calhoun nodded, with a thin smile. As it chances, I need a man. Ergo, and very plainly, I must use a woman. They looked at each other for a moment. That Calhoun planned some deep-laid stratagem was plain, but his speech for the time remained enigmatic, even to his most intimate companion. There are two women in our world today, said Calhoun. As to Jackson, the old fool was a monogamist and still is. Not so much so Jim Polk of Tennessee. Never does he appear in public with eyes other than for the Doña Lucrezia of the Mexican legation. Now one against the other, Mexico against Austria. Dr. Ward raised his eyebrows in perplexity. That is to say, England, and not Austria, went on Calhoun coldly. The ambassadress of England to America was born in Budapest. So I say Austria, or perhaps Hungary, or some other country, which raised this strange representative who has made some stir in Washington here these last few weeks. Ah, you mean the Baroness, exclaimed Dr. Ward. Tut, tut. Calhoun nodded, with the same cold, thin smile. Yes, he said, I mean Mr. Pakenham's reputed mistress, his assured secret agent and spy, the beautiful Baroness von Ritz. He mentioned a name then well known in diplomatic and social life, when intrigue in Washington, if not open, was none too well hidden. Gay Sir Richard, he resumed. You know, his ancestor was a brother-in-law of the Duke of Wellington. He himself seems to have absorbed some of the great duke's fondness for the fair. Before he came to us, he was with England's legation in Mexico. 'Twas there he first met the Doña Lucrezia. 'Tis said he would have remained in Mexico had it not been arranged that she and her husband, Señor Iturrio, should accompany General Almonte in the Mexican ministry here. On these conditions, Sir Richard agreed to accept promotion as Minister Plenipotentiary to Washington. That was 9 years ago, commented Dr. Ward. Yes, and it was only last fall that he was made envoy extraordinary. He is at least an extraordinary envoy. Near 50 years of age, he seems to forget public decency. He forgets even the Doña Lucrezia, leaving her to the admiration of Mr. Polk and Mr. Van Zant, and follows off after the sprightly Baroness von Ritz. Meantime, Señor Iturrio also forgets the Doña Lucrezia and proceeds also to follow after the Baroness, although with less hope than Sir Richard, as they say. At least Pakenham has taste. The Baroness von Ritz has brains and beauty both. It is she who is England's real envoy. Now I believe she knows England's real intentions as to Texas. Dr. Ward screwed his lips for a long whistle as he contemplated John Calhoun's thin, determined face. I do not care at present to say more, went on my chief. But do you not see, granted certain motives, Polk might come into power pledged to the extension of our southwest borders? Calhoun, are you mad? Cried his friend. Would you plunge this country into war? Would you pit two peoples, like cocks on a floor? And would you use women in our diplomacy? Calhoun now was no longer the friend, the humanitarian. He was the relentless machine, the idea, the single purpose, which to the world at large he had been all his life in Congress, in cabinets, on this or the other side of the throne of American power. He spoke coldly as he went on. In these matters, it is not a question of means, but of results. If war comes, let it come, although I hope it will not come. As to the use of women, tell me, why not women? Why anything else but women? It is only playing life against life, one variant against another. That is politics, my friend. I want Pakenham. So I must learn what Pakenham wants. Does he want Texas for England, or the Baroness von Ritz for himself? Ward still sat and looked at him. My God, said he at last softly, but Calhoun went on. Why, who has made the maps of the world, and who has written pages in its history? Who makes and unmakes cities and empires and republics today? Woman and not man. Are you so ignorant, and you a physician who know them both? Gad, man, you do not understand your own profession, and yet you seek to counsel me in mine. Strange words from you, John, commented his friend, shaking his head. Not seemly for a man who stands where you stand today. Strange weapons, yes. If I could always use my old weapons of tongue and brain, I would not need these, perhaps. Now you tell me my time is short. I must fight now to win. I have never fought to lose. I cannot be too nice in agents and instruments. The old doctor rose and took a turn up and down the little room, one of Calhoun's modest menage at the nation's capital, which then was not the city it is today. Calhoun followed him with even steps. Changes of maps, my friend. Listen to me. The geography of America for the next 50 years rests under a little roof over in M Street tonight, a roof which Sir Richard secretly maintains. The map of the United States, I tell you, is covered with a down counterpane edur tonight. You ask me to go on with my fight. I answer, first I must find the woman. Now I say, I have found her, as you know. Also, I have told you where I have found her. Under a counterpane. Texas, Oregon, these United States under a counterpane. Dr. Ward sighed as he shook his head. I don't pretend to know now all you mean. Calhoun whirled on him fiercely, with a vigor which his wasted frame did not indicate as possible. Listen then, and I will tell you what John Calhoun means. John Calhoun, who has loved his own state, who has hated those who hated him, who has never prayed for those who despitefully used him, who has fought and will fight, since all insist on that. It is true Tyler has offered me again today the portfolio of Secretary of State. Shall I take it? If I do, it means that I am employed by this administration to secure the admission of Texas. Can you believe me when I tell you that my ambition is for it all, every foot of new land west to the Pacific that we can get, slave or free? Can you believe John Calhoun, pro-slavery advocate and orator all his life, when he says that he believes he is an humble instrument, destined with God's aid, and through the use of such instruments as our human society affords to build, not a wider slave country, but a wider America? It would be worth the fight of a few years more, Calhoun, gravely answered his old friend. I admit, I had not dreamed this of you. History will not write it of me, perhaps, went on my chief. But you tell me to fight, and now I shall fight, and in my own way. I tell you, that answer shall go to Pakenham. And I tell you, Pakenham shall not dare take offense at me. War with Mexico, we possibly, indeed certainly, shall have. War on the Northwest, too, we yet may have unless, he paused, and Dr. Ward prompted him some moments later, as he still remained in thought. Unless what, John? What do you mean, still hearing the rustle of skirts? Yes, unless the celebrated Baroness Helena von Ritz says otherwise, replied he grimly. How dignified a diplomacy have we here? You plan war between two embassies on the distaff side, smiled Dr. Ward. Calhoun continued his walk. I do not say so, he made answer. But if there must be war, we may reflect that war is at its best when woman is in the field. End of chapter. Chapter 2, by Special Dispatch. In all eras and all climes, a woman of great genius or beauty has done what she chose. Uido. Nicholas, said Calhoun, turning to me suddenly but with his invariable kindliness of tone, oblige me tonight. I have written a message here. You will see the address. I have unavoidably heard this lady's name, I hesitated. You will find the lady's name above the seal. Take her this message from me. Yes, your errand is to bring the least known and most talked of woman in Washington, alone, unattended save by yourself, to a gentleman's apartments, to his house, at a time past the hour of midnight. That gentleman is myself. You must not take any answer in the negative. As I sat dumbly, holding this sealed document in my hand, he turned to Dr. Ward, with a nod toward myself. I choose my young aide, Mr. Trist here, for good reasons. He is just back from 6 months in the wilderness and may be shy, but once he had a way with women, so they tell me. And you know, in approaching the question ad feminem, we operate per hominem. Dr. Ward took snuff with violence as he regarded me critically. I do not doubt the young man's sincerity and faithfulness, said he. I was only questioning one thing. Yes? His age. Calhoun rubbed his chin. Nicholas, said he, you heard me. I have no wish to encumber you with useless instructions. Your errand is before you. Very much depends upon it, as you have heard. All I can say is, keep your head, keep your feet, and keep your heart. The two older men both turned now, and smiled at me, in a manner not wholly to my liking. Neither was this errand to my liking. It was true, I was hardly arrived home after many months in the West, but I had certain plans of my own for that very night, and although as yet I had made no definite engagement with my fiancée, Miss Elizabeth Churchill, of Elmhurst Farm, for meeting her at the great ball this night, such certainly was my desire and my intention. Why, I had scarce seen Elizabeth twice in the last year. How now, Nick, my son, began my chief. Have staff and scrip been your portion so long that you are wholly wedded to them? Come, I think the night might promise you something of interest. I assure you of one thing, you will receive no willing answer from the fair baroness. She will scoff at you, and perhaps bid you farewell. See to it then, do what you like, but bring her with you, and bring her here. You will realize the importance of all this when I tell you that my answer to Mr. Tyler must be in before noon tomorrow. That answer will depend upon the answer the Baroness von Ritz makes to me, here, tonight. I cannot go to her, so she must come to me. You have often served me well, my son. Serve me tonight. My time is short, I have no moves to lose. It is you who will decide before morning whether or not John Calhoun is the next Secretary of State. And that will decide whether or not Texas is to be a state. I had never seen Mr. Calhoun so intent, so absorbed. We all three now sat silent in the little room where the candles guttered in the great glass cylinders on the mantel, an apartment scarce better lighted by the further aid of lamps fed by oil. "He might be older," said Calhoun at length, speaking of me as though I were not present. "And 'tis a hard game to play. If once my Lady Helena takes it into her merry head to make it so for him. But if I sent one shorter of stature and uglier of visage, and with less art in approaching a crinoline, why, perhaps he would get no farther than her door. No, he will serve, he must serve." He arose now, and bowed to us both, even as I rose and turned for my cloak to shield me from the raw drizzle which then was falling in the streets. Dr. Ward reached down his own shaggy top hat from the rack. "To bed with you now, John," said he sternly. "No, I must write. You heard me say, to bed with you. A stiff toddy to make you sleep. Nicholas here may wake you soon enough, with his mysterious companion. I think tomorrow will be time enough for you to work, and tomorrow very likely will bring work for you to do." Calhoun sighed. "God," he exclaimed, "if I but had back my strength! If there were more than those scant remaining years!" "Go," said he suddenly, and so we others passed down his step and out into the semi-lighted streets. So this, then, was my errand. My mind still tingled at its unwelcome quality. Dr. Ward guessed something of my mental dissatisfaction. "Never mind, Nicholas," said he, as we parted at the street corner, where he climbed into the rickety carriage which his colored driver held awaiting him. "Never mind. I don't myself quite know what Calhoun wants, but he would not ask of you anything personally improper. Do his errand, then. It is part of your work. In any case," and I thought I saw him grin in the dim light, "you may have a night which you will remember." There proved to be truth in what he said. End of chapter. Chapter 3. In Argument. The egotism of women is always for two. Me. De style. The thought of missing my meeting with Elizabeth still rankled in my soul. Had it been another man who asked me to carry this message, I must have refused. But this man was my master, my chief, in whose service I had engaged. Strange enough, it may seem to give John Calhoun any title showing love or respect. Today most men call him traitor, call him the man responsible for the war between North and South, call him the arch-apostle of that impossible doctrine of slavery which we all now admit was wrong. Why, then, should I love him as I did? I cannot say except that I always loved, honored, and admired courage, uprightness, integrity. For myself, his agent, I had, as I say, left the old Trist homestead at the foot of South Mountain in Maryland to seek my fortune in our capital city. I had had some 3 or 4 years' semi-diplomatic training when I first met Calhoun and entered his service as assistant. It was under him that I finished my studies in law. Meantime, I was his messenger in very many quests, his source of information in many matters where he had no time to go into details. Strange enough had been some of the circumstances in which I found myself thrust through this relation with a man so intimately connected for a generation with our public life. Adventures were always to my liking, and surely I had my share. I knew the frontier marches of Tennessee and Alabama, the intricacies of politics of Ohio and New York, mixed as those things were in Tyler's time. I had even been as far west as the Rockies, of which young Fremont was now beginning to write so understandingly. For 6 months I had been in Mississippi and Texas, studying matters and men, and now, just back from...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.